Welcome back to the show, another edition of Beyond Reason Radio. Here at beyondreasonradio.com and the Beyond Reason Radio app. It's Friday, it's 8 p.m. I'm not on vacation anymore. So I'm back here to be your voice of reason in a world that is beyond reason. And if there was ever a week in our country, in Orlando, which is where I broadcast out of, where I live, that was beyond reason, it was this week. Lots of stuff. Unfortunately, a lot of bad stuff happened this week that was just crazy beyond reason. So also, special note, I will be hosting Good Morning Orlando on 102.5 WFLA Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday of next week. You can listen if you're in Orlando on 102.5 FM or 540 AM, or just go on iHeartRadio and search 102.5 News Radio 102.5, and you will find it. So today, I know it's been a long week for a lot of you, but I want you to stick with me for an hour, because we're still got some important stuff to discuss. We still got some important issues to discuss, and we're going to get deep into the issues. And I don't go away from controversy on this show. We go straight on into the controversy. We go straight on into the deep issues because they're important. They're important to talk about. They're important to know, and we need to talk about them. So we are going to talk about them. The big issues, of course, this week surrounding the horrible shooting, the evil that happened in my city last weekend. And the two big issues that have been coming up are, should we say radical Islam in naming the enemy? Now, Trump made a speech. I played a lot of the speech on Monday's show. If you want to go listen to the podcast of that, you can. I talked a lot about it. But he talked about how Hillary Clinton and Barack Obama, they are afraid to name the enemy by its name, which is radical Islamic terrorism. They're afraid to say those words. Or I hate to say the word afraid, because I don't think they're afraid. They don't want to do it. It's political correctness. It's not wanting to offend Muslims. It's trying to keep peace with all these Muslim countries that believe in that kind of ideology. So it's part of that. But Trump says we need to do it. And a lot of people say we need to do it. And Obama came out and he made another little speech. He seemed more mad. Trump said this in his speech, and I agree. Obama seemed more mad at Trump calling out Obama than he did at the killer in Orlando, which is very interesting, but it seemed like it, where he said, what does it matter if we say it or not? It's not going to stop us going after the enemy. It's not going to stop us fighting terrorism. We don't need to say it. All it does is offend people in a religion. And of course, conservatives like us have to say over and over again, they know this. They know this, but it's politics. We're not saying all Muslims are bad. We need good Muslims on our side to fight, what I've been saying on the show forever, the war of ideas. We need good Muslims on our side to fight that. We're talking about the radical element that is taking over a lot of the Islamic religion and it's spreading all over the world. Radical Islamic terrorism, radical jihadism. And people ask me, why do we need to say it? Why do we need to say radical Islamic terrorism? Why is it important for us to say that? So I'm going to talk about this first. Later, we're going to talk about the whole gun control thing. It's become a big issue once again. And basically, it's become a big issue because the Democrats and Obama have made it a big issue. Again, they're using another tragedy to push gun control like they always do. It's not too surprising. It's pretty predictable. But I'm going to talk about radical Islamic terrorism. Why do we need to say those words? Well, actually, the best explanation I heard all week was by a national security expert, counterterrorism expert that comes on Fox News. He's also chair of military theory at Marine Corps University. His name is Sebastian Gorka. He's wrote a book on this and everything. And I want to play his comments before I talk about my own of why it is important to say the words when calling the enemy radical Islamic terrorism. Remember, radical Islamic terrorism, radical jihadism. Why is it important to that, to say that? And what Gorka says here, it's very telling. I couldn't have said it better myself. It's the best comment I heard, and he's very serious, but it's something we need to hear. So here is his comment.
We need to stop using words like shocking. Nobody should be shocked. This is what they have been planning to do. After Paris, after Brussels, nobody should be surprised. Likewise, this isn't to be called a tragedy. This isn't an Amtrak train being derailed. This is part of the global jihadi strategy. It's not an accident. It is war against America. And lastly, please, please, I beg my colleagues in the U.S. government, we have to stop talking about this maybe being a hate crime. It's not a hate crime. It is part of an ideological military assault on the United States of America. We have arrested 101 people linked to ISIS on U.S. soil since the caliphate was declared. This attack in part was facilitated by the policies of this administration, President Obama and Secretary Clinton, that have allowed political correctness into the threat assessment. Today, I beg the White House, stop with the political correctness. We need to destroy this enemy before more innocent people, gay, straight, black, white, brown, yellow, are murdered on U.S. soil.
So, we'll talk more about why it's important to say radical Islamic terrorism then, why it's important to name the enemy. But he says a couple of things that I thought were very interesting there. One, he said we need to stop calling it a tragedy. It's not a tragedy like a train derailment or a car accident or something. This is war. This is evil. This is an attack on America. Excellent point. I couldn't have said it better myself. Another thing. He says we need to stop saying the words shocked. We really should not be shocked by this. It has been spreading around the world. And the Islamic State, they're really just a part of it. Al-Qaeda, all these radical Islamic groups in the world that are spreading their ideology everywhere are warning us, telling us that they are going to do this. And it's Ramadan. And they said they were going to do this during Ramadan. He makes some good points. And then he says, the political correctness in the White House, the idea in the White House and policies in the White House and the executive branch of government by not willing to name the enemy is hurting us because they can't do proper investigation to prevent stuff like this. And they're not going to fight what I've been saying forever. The war of ideas properly. Remember, this is a war of ideas. It's an ideology, our values, our American ideology versus the radical Islamic ideology that is spreading around the world. That is why it is important to name the enemy by its name. Now, I'm going to give you some other examples of this, but Sebastian Gorka has a second comment here. And he gets a little bit more specific on what we need to do to fight this enemy. And the root is naming its, recognizing who the enemy is. Because the Democrat Party and Obama and a lot of people now, it's all about guns now. It's the gun. The gun is not the enemy. I'm telling you right now, the gun is not the enemy. And there's reasons why. You can't say the gun's the enemy. That merely banning a one type of gun is not going to really do any good. And I've been warning you about this for a long time. It's a distraction. But here's what Gorka says. Very interesting.
Well, right now we have, as your previous guest noted, more than 900 leads being investigated by the FBI in every single state of the union. What we need to know right now is who this person was connected to, how were they accessing ideological material, who those ideologues were. This person killed 50 people. That is more than one magazine worth of rounds inside a rifle, inside an AR rifle. This means he probably had some kind of training. Who gave him that training. We have to find out the broader network, and most importantly, not just the connections to ISIS or jihadis, but who are the ideologues, the people he was in touch with that spun him up to do this attack now during the season of Ramadan. This is, I know the FBI are doing this right now. We have to give them as much leeway as possible and stop the political correct.
We have to give them as much leeway as possible. And he even mentions it here. We can't just focus on ISIS. We can't just focus on Al-Qaeda. We have to focus on the ideologues, the radical Muslim ideologues. And some of them are in this country. So there's 900 investigations all over the country. They're in this country. And they're spreading an ideology. And then they're spreading it over the internet. And then it's spreading across the world. We have to get serious about the enemy, because this is a guerrilla war. It is a war against America and American values. But it's also very much an ideological war. We have to convince more and more people that that radical ideology that is spreading, it is evil. And the only way we can do that is if we say it is what it is and contrast it with our good ideology. Now, in some ways, we did a great job of that this week. In Orlando, we showed what it's like to come together, to unite, to show love and compassion to people who maybe you even disagree with. That's great. That's great. But now it's become, once again, about the gun. But that's silly, because look at the last terrorist attacks we had. Not us, but even the world. The last ones we had San Bernardino. Okay. They used an AR-15. By the way, it was not an AR-15 used in this attack. It was a high magazine rifle, but I keep hearing people say weapons of war. I guarantee you, in a war, we are not using AR-15s. They are only semi-automatic guns. We would die. You can't use that. But look at the other attacks. Paris. Paris was the latest big attack, and that was in Europe. Paris has strict gun control laws. It didn't stop them. The attack before that, Brussels. What did they use in Brussels? They used bombs. They used explosives of people in an airport. And it's just, they blew people up. They didn't need guns. What happened before that? Charlie Hebdo. The attack on the Charlie Hebdo magazine in France was also strict gun control. Even some of the cops couldn't fight back because they didn't have guns. And yet we're making this about the guns. Here, the Boston terrorist attack. It's not about guns. It's about the war of ideas. It's about radical Islamic terrorism, about the radical ideology, and we have to understand it, and we have to fight against that ideology. That is why we have to say it. That's why we have to say it. Because if we don't, we're in trouble. Now, another example of how we can be in trouble, and how our administration and how people in our government are still not willing to fight the war of ideas, is you look at this report. This is from the Washington Free Beacon. Homeland Security report calls for rejecting terms like jihad and Sharia. What it is Department of Homeland Security, they want to target millennials encountering Islamist recruitment. Okay, that's a good thing. Finally, fight the ideology. We're going to go online. But what did they put? They want to go away from the terms jihad and Sharia in programs aimed at countering terrorist radicalization among American youth. Why? Well, we all know why. Because they're afraid of offending Muslims. But our enemy is using those terms constantly. We have to be able to engage them on these terms. We can't just stand back. The department's CVE efforts, the counter-recruitment efforts, are an attempt to protect our nation's young people from extremists. That's good. The department must reframe the conversation to reflect this reality and design a robust program in protection of our youth. That's good. But under the section on terminology, The report calls for rejecting use of us versus them mentality by shunning Islamic language and countering violent extremism programs, or CVE, the Obama administration's euphemism that seeks to avoid references to Islam. Our enemy is are using those references. When good Muslims stand up, they have to use those references to fight them on the battle of ideas. So once again, why is it important to use the terms radical Islam? I explained a lot. Another thing, when we're talking about world affairs, if we're not understanding that our enemy is an ideological enemy that's all over the place, it's going to affect our foreign policy. For instance, example number one, we have tried to negotiate with Iran. The whole nuke deal with Iran that gives them tons of money and basically doesn't stop them from getting nukes, but it gives them a lot of money. If we understand we're fighting a radical ideology that is spreading around the world, we wouldn't do that. Because by giving that regime who believes in that radical ideology tons of money, it goes straight into the hands of terrorists, goes straight into the hands of recruitment, it spreads the ideology more. But because our administration doesn't understand that ideology, that what we're fighting, we continue to do that. Another example, the Arab Spring. Everybody loved the Arab Spring in Egypt when it started, but there was conservatives who warned that we have to be very careful because a lot of this radical ideology spreading around the world has its roots in the Muslim Brotherhood. The Muslim Brotherhood has its roots in Egypt. Okay, so even though we didn't necessarily like Sadat, it would be much worse to put the Muslim Brotherhood in power because, once again, it's that radical ideology that would take root in a country. We supported ousting Sadat anyway. The Muslim Brotherhood ended up taking control anyway, and it made the situation in Egypt much worse. Luckily, and Christians were persecuted and killed for it. Luckily, The Egyptian people woke up again and took out the Muslim Brotherhood. The same thing happened in Libya. We wanted to take out Gaddafi. Gaddafi's evil. We have to take him out. And people, conservatives warned, we can't do that because it could get the Muslim radicals to take over the country. We didn't listen anyways because we don't want to admit that there is a radical ideology spreading over there. Oh, you just hate Muslims when you say that. You just hate Muslims when you say that. No, we don't hate Muslims, but there's a large group of Muslims in that area of the world that are powerful, that are evil, that are trying to take over those countries, and when they do, it gives them a lot of power to spread that ideology. What happened in Libya? Same thing. It broke down. We had the whole Benghazi incident. This is what happens when you don't name the enemy. When you don't fight on ideological grounds, when is the president going to go make speeches directly towards these countries saying, do not fall into the trap of this radical Islamic ideology that's spreading over there? Instead, look to America for your hope. Look at America for the way to the future. And this is why America's great, and this is why that radical Islamic ideology is not. You're not going to hear from this president because, oh, we don't want to offend Muslims. We're not going to get the good Muslims on our side unless we say the truth. And that's where we are. And yet, like I said, I have this report from the Department of Homeland Security that says, no, we can't do that. The jihadists, there was a comment here on this Washington Free Beacon article. Jihadists are the ones who have made this fight us versus them. With every violent terrorist attack, from bringing down the World Trade Center towers, killing American soldiers overseas, beheading journalists, or shooting Americans in Orlando. The Department of Homeland Security's emphasis here on political correctness is absolutely dangerous and places America and our military at risk. Exactly right, because the FBI's hands are tied. I've seen interviews from former FBI heads and agents who are saying we can't really fight the enemy. We're, our hands are tied because we're so afraid of offending Muslims. We have to get away from that. Does that mean we need to ban all Muslims from entering the country? No, that's stupid. It can't be done. Does that mean we have to hate all Muslims? No, there are good Muslims who will want to be on our side. Does that mean we have to hate all Muslim countries? No. So, and I've talked about before, the whole Muslim ban, I was against that when Trump said it. But I also don't think it's unreasonable to ban immigration for a while from countries where these terrorist organizations are taking hold, like Syria, Iraq, Iran, other countries, because Lebanon, because ISIS has said themselves that they are going to use refugees to infiltrate countries. They've said it, and they've said it again, and the Department of Homeland Security Secretary said it. Actually, the CIA, Brennan, CIA had Brennan said it this week, that they're going to use refugee programs. So if Trump was smart, which Ted Cruz had said that, we could have went on a more reasonable route. I don't think it's unreasonable to want to control immigration. We've done it since the beginning of this country. All countries do it. You have to control immigration. But we have to be smart about who we're fighting. And I hear this all, why do we have to name the enemy? Why? It's not going to change anything. It's not going to change anything. I have direct examples that I just give you of how it can change things. Now, in the next segment, I have audio from the Prime Minister of Israel, Benjamin Netanyahu, who put out a video right after the Orlando attack. And he said what I wanted Obama to say, what I want other world leaders to say. He showed true leadership in after this attack. And so I want to play his cut because it's very, once again, it's very important. There is someone right there who understands what we're fighting, and we have to fight it. And it, remember what I said. If you take anything out of this monologue, you take anything out of this segment, anything out of the show that I've been saying for weeks, you have to remember it's a war of ideas. It's an ideological war as well as a physical war. We have to go to ISIS strongholds and wipe them out. Yes, of course we do. We have to show that you don't mess with America. You don't attack America. But it's not going to work until we fight it on ideological grounds. We did it during the Cold War. We did it after World War II. We have to do it now. We can't be afraid of being offending someone. You're going to offend someone, and hopefully you'll offend the enemy, and hopefully you'll take good Muslims and make sure that they don't go to that radical ideology. So I'm going to play that audio next. We're also going to play talks on gun control and why some of the best defenses of the Second Amendment I've heard from other people out there. I'm going to play that as well. You are listening to Beyond Reason Radio. I'm your voice of reason in a world that is beyond reason. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee. And we will be right back.
You want to listen to Beyond Reason Radio live on your smartphone? Download the Beyond Reason Radio app now. Available in the Google Play or Apple App Stores.
There are so many clothing fads out there that are just beyond reason. But here at Beyond Reason Radio, we want to let you in on a new patriotic fad that will never fade. That fad stands for Freedom All Day. Freedom All Day is the latest apparel brand for the true patriot who is not afraid to show it. Their mission is to give people an opportunity to show patriotism all year and to do it while looking good. Check out their latest stuff, including their newest t-shirts at freedomalldayapparel.com. At freedomalldayapparel.com, you can find all kinds of different cool-looking t-shirts, and they are all made in America. Go to freedomalldayapparel.com and be part of the fad that never fades.
If you like Beyond Reason Radio, well, make sure to show it by liking the Facebook page at facebook.com/Beyond Reason Radio.
Welcome back to the show, everyone. It's another edition of Beyond Reason Radio. We do this show every Monday and Friday at 8 p.m. live at beyondreasonradio.com, at Facebook, on Facebook Live, and on the Beyond Reason Radio app. I'm your host, Michael Yaffee, the voice of reason in a world that is beyond reason. Don't forget to follow me on Twitter at Beyond Reason R. That is Beyond Reason and the letter R. By the way, I am going to end the show. Like I did, I didn't get to do it on Monday. It was a very serious show, Monday. But I am going to end the show with stories so beyond reason, to leave you flabbergasted. We'll end on a little bit of a lighter note. A lot of people like that segment. And by the way, if you want to chat with the show when I'm doing the show live, you can chat with the show on the app. There's a chat button on beyondreview.com, or you can send me a comment on Facebook Live as well. So I told you, before you go into the next break, I told you I'm going to play audio from the Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu, because what he said to me showed true leadership. It's what I want to hear our leaders say when it comes to this enemy, when it comes to these terrorist attacks. It's what I want them to say. And I thought he put it better than any leader I've heard so far. So this is what he had to say. You can, like I said, chat with the show. You can tell me what you think as well, or what you think of my comments in the first segment. Here it is.
In Orlando, a terrorist walks into a nightclub and murders nearly 50 human beings. Sons and daughters, brothers and sisters, cut down in cold blood. They did nothing wrong. They were dancing with friends. They were enjoying music with loved ones. Why did the terrorist murder them? Because he was driven by a fanatical hatred. He targeted the LGBT community because he believed they were evil. Now, the murderer wasn't alone. Regime and terrorist organizations around the world ruthlessly persecute the LGBT community. In Syria, ISIS throws gays off rooftops. In Iran, the regime hangs gays from cranes. Too many people have remained silent in the face of this awful persecution. This week's shooting wasn't merely an attack on the LGBT community. It was an attack on all of us, on our common values of freedom and diversity and choice. Radical Islamist terror makes no distinction between shades of infidel. This week it was gays in Orlando. A few days before that it was Jews in Tel Aviv. Before that it was music fans in Paris, travelers in Brussels, Yazidis in Iraq, community workers in San Bernardino, Christians and journalists in Syria. All of us are targets. We believe that all people are created in the image of God. ISIS, by contrast, believes that all people who aren't just like them deserve to die. We will not be terrified into submission. We will fight back, and we will triumph. Today, I ask you to reach out to friends in the LGBT community. Comfort them. Tell them you stand together. We stand together as one. And that you will always remember the victims. Tell them they'll never be alone. That we are all one family, deserving of dignity, deserving of life. I have no doubt that those who seek to spread hate and fear will be defeated. Working together will defeat them even faster. We need to stand united, resolute, in the belief that all people, regardless of their sexual orientation, regardless of their race, regardless of their ethnicity, all people deserve respect, deserve dignity.
I couldn't have said it better myself. And what was the main focus of that speech there by Benjamin Netanyahu? It was once again the ideological battle, that we have to stand resolute, that we have to stand firm, that we have to fight the enemy and tell them that they cannot win. Didn't shift to guns or anything else. He didn't say he hated all Muslims. He said, as a Western community, he believes we all are made in the image of God, and that we have to stand together to fight that enemy. And that is going to be the best way to defeat them. It's just true leadership that I was just really glad to hear. It needs to be said more. He gets it. And he named a bunch of other terrorist attacks that are happening. And he says, look, they're just targeting anyone who disagrees with them. And they're going to keep doing it. But unless we fight back. And I like that. I didn't really hear that from the president here. It's really unfortunate. All right, when we get back, we have to talk about the gun control issue. I've heard some really good things about the Second Amendment. People are asking, why do we need assault weapons? Why do we need these weapons of war? I keep hearing that. So we're going to talk about it. We're going to talk about that next. You're listening to Beyond Reason Radio here at beyondreasonradio.com and streaming live on the Beyond Reason Radio app. Don't forget, if you want to chat with the show, you can live here on the app or on Facebook Live as well. And, well, I'll be right back.
If you heart Beyond Reason Radio, listen to the Beyond Reason Radio podcast on iHeartRadio. Just download the iHeartRadio app and search Beyond Reason Radio.
There are so many clothing fads out there that are just beyond reason. But here at Beyond Reason Radio, we want to let you in on a new patriotic fad that will never fade. That fad stands for Freedom All Day. Freedom All Day is the latest apparel brand for the true patriot who is not afraid to show it. Their mission is to give people an opportunity to show patriotism all year and to do it while looking good. Check out their latest stuff, including their newest t-shirts at freedomalldayapparel.com. At freedomalldayapparel.com, you can find all kinds of different cool-looking t-shirts, and they are all made in America. Go to freedomalldayapparel.com and be part of the fad that never fades.
If you miss any of the show, you can download the Beyond Reason podcast on iTunes.
Welcome back, everyone. This is Orlando Smart Talk Radio. This is Beyond Reason Radio. We do this show every Monday and Friday at 8 p.m. on the Beyond Reason Radio app at beyondreasonradio.com and on Facebook Live as well. You can follow me on Facebook at Beyond Reason Radio. You can follow me on Twitter at Beyond Reason R. So, of course, once again, every time something like this happens, unfortunately, the first thing that comes up is some kind of gun control, unfortunately. And Obama, he came to visit the families of the victims in Orlando. I have no problem with that. The first part of his speech was actually very good. I had no problem with them talking about the victims, talking about us standing together, talking about us showing love, talking about us helping the victims. But then he shifted, once again, of course, kind of predictable, to gun control. And I want to first play, before I get into what I think about it, I want to play what Obama said here about gun control. And it's very interesting when you actually think about what he left out as well. And by the way, you can comment anytime during the show. You can chat with the show on the app, on beyondreasonradio.com, or on Facebook Live as well. And give your comment, I'll mention it on the air. This is what Obama said.
Unfortunately, our politics have conspired to make it as easy as possible for a terrorist or just a disturbed individual like those in Aurora and Newtown to buy extraordinarily powerful weapons, and they can do so legally.
Now, the killer in Newtown did not buy them legally. He got them illegally. He stole them from his mother after he killed her. But what's very interesting about that comment is he did not mention some of the other mass killings. Why? Because those kind of weapons, the quote-unquote assault weapon, AR-15 or whatever kind like it, was not used in some of the other mass killings. It was not used in Virginia Tech, handguns were. It was not used in Charleston, handguns were. The shooting against those two reporters not too long ago, that was a handgun. Then you look at the Boston bombing, those were bombs. Brussels, that was bombs. He conveniently leaves that out because banning one type of gun is not going to do anything here. So people ask me, okay, so why do we need this kind of gun anyway? Well, there's a couple of responses I'll give you first. For one, it's because if you ban this particular kind of gun, High Magazine, whatever, it's not going to end there. It never does. Because there will be more shootings, especially since we're not fighting the enemy like we should be. Because there could be, I hope not. I pray there's never another one. But if there are, and there probably will be, And say we ban these all these assault rifles and there's more shootings and they're done without that kind of weapon. The next push is going to be to ban handguns, to eventually ban all guns. That's going to be what's coming, because banning this one type of gun is not going to do anything. So people are, rightly so, afraid of the slippery slope. The other reason, and this is the biggest politically incorrect reason ever, I've talked about it before, historians know this, they don't like to mention it. One of the reasons why the founding fathers gave citizens the right to bear arms was to protect themselves from a tyrannical government if they had to. People don't want to say that. People don't want to think about that. Oh, we can never fight against a military. We would never do that. We'll always be a free country. People that like that don't know history. The fact is, an armed citizenry, good people with guns as citizens, is another final check on government tyranny. The government will always think twice about tyrannizing the public. You know, if we got a dictator or something, they would always think twice about doing it, and they wouldn't be as effective because our population is armed. We don't want to think about that, but it's very true. There's a reason why the government put that in there. And that was one of the big reasons, to protect against government tyranny. That's why they have the militia thing as well. And I'm going to play some audio here with Judge Andrew Napolitano from Fox News. Very great on this issue. But one thing he said is, we actually have a right to monitor. We say, oh, well, the founding fathers, they didn't have guns like this today, so they didn't mean that. They meant like muskets and stuff, because that's what it was back in the day. But he says no. He says we actually have the right to modern-day weapons because they use the word "the right to bear arms." By saying "the right to bear arms," that was done on purpose, because it's a natural right to have these weapons. And it means for all time, weapons against war. Whatever weapons they had in the past, whatever weapons we can have in the future. The right. And there's more online about that if you want to check Andrew Napolitano's take. But I have some audio here from him as well, where he talks about this issue. And this is one of the best defenses I've heard of the Second Amendment, because he makes clear why we need it, even just for self-defense. And listen closely when he talks about what the AR-15 kind of can do. How there's times when he had to reload, yet no one still could stop him. When he talks about the amount of shots, listen closely to this. It's really good. It's the best defense I've heard. And there's other things I'm going to talk about, but listen to this closely.
Welcome to my chambers. A very difficult week for the people in Orlando, Florida. A difficult week for Americans. Difficult for us to cover the tragedies that happened there. Death is a tragedy, especially tragic when it's a violent death. It's particularly tragic when it's the death of young people. It's monumentally tragic when it's senseless. I don't want to talk about the reasons for the killing, other than to talk about the government's involvement. In all of these mass killings by guns in the modern era, whether it's Aurora or Newtown or San Bernardino or Charleston or Columbine or now Orlando, the one thing in common is that they occur in what the government cheerfully calls a gun-free zone. They should be called killing zones, because that's what they are. These are areas where the government prohibits law-abiding citizens who are lawfully authorized to carry guns from carrying guns. So in all these places, a lot of the victims themselves had guns and the right to carry them, but weren't permitted to bring them into the venue, and the killers know that. It's an example of the government interfering with our fundamental liberty because it thinks it can take better care of us than we can take care of ourselves. If anything is obvious from these tragedies, beyond a reasonable doubt, it is that the government cannot keep us safe. But for the government to assault our ability to defend ourselves violates the natural law. Your right to defend yourself is your natural right. Violates the Constitution. Your right to keep and bear arms, modern-day, workable, usable arms that you have with you, is protected by the Constitution. And it violates common sense. anybody in that nightclub in Orlando had had a gun and knew how to use it, they could have stopped the killer. He fired 250 shots out of two weapons. He reloaded 12 times. It's impossible to shoot a weapon and reload it at the same time. There were many periods of downtime during which one person, one gun, one bullet could have stopped him. It is reprehensible that the government has interfered with these rights. The right to keep and bear arms is a sacred right. It is a natural right. It is in the same category of speech and press and religion and travel and privacy. Why do we need a permission slip from the government to protect ourselves when we don't need a permission slip from the government for our other rights? That's what politicians want to do. Take away our right to keep us safe when they have failed miserably to do so. Welcome to my chambers.
I really thought that was good. I thought that was great because he made the part that really fascinated me is he talked about, you know, we talk about high capacity rounds. It was the type of gun that was the problem. He had to reload 12 times. There, you can't fire and reload at the same time. When there is downtime, and there was apparently a lot of downtime in this instant, all it takes is one person, one good guy with a gun to stop him. But this was another place that was a gun-free zone. Our culture is now saying we want to ban guns everywhere. It's not the type of gun. Think if you had the type of gun he had, you could defend yourself better. But we become so afraid of guns. And it's just hurting us even more. And he talked about it's our natural right to defend ourselves. And in order to defend ourselves, not only from other people, but from a tyrannical government, we need modern arms. So that's why this is an issue. That's why people are like, we don't need these kind of guns in our society. Maybe not at the moment, but we will. And by the way, this is kind of a side note. The same people that say things like we don't need this type of gun in our society often push for a lot of other things that we don't need in our society, but they think those should be legal. I mean, let's look at marijuana. Do we really need marijuana, recreational marijuana in our society? No, it probably will do a lot of damage. But same people want to ban guns are the same people that say, oh, we have to legalize that. They don't seem to care about a need in our society there. But listen to what he said. It's our right. And, you know, I have no stake in this. I don't own that type of gun. I have no stake in that. But it's about defending our rights as Americans and as human beings and the slippery slope that can go from there. Now, believe it or not, one of the other best defenses of the Second Amendment I heard was from all people, Howard Stern, of all people, if you can believe that. I mean, if he is going to talk about defending our gun rights, you know, I talked about on the last show, something has changed. I don't think people are going to necessarily blame the gun. There is a push in Orlando right now to ban assault weapons in Orlando, which he'll just go to another city outside of Orlando and bring it back. What good is it to just ban, oh, the weapon's banned in Orlando. That means they're not going to come here ever. It makes no sense. If you want to ban it across the country, even that doesn't make sense because the criminals will still find a way to get it. So the whole ban in Orlando, I mean, you could just go to like Sanford something and grab it and just bring it back. The criminals are not going to care about the laws. They don't care about the gun-free zones. It's obvious. But Howard Stern, of all people, said something very interesting about this, and I have to read it to you. He said, I'm so upset about Orlando and what went down, but I can't believe these people would come out afterward and their answer to Orlando is to take away guns from the public. It's effing mind-blowing to me. He's very passionate about this. He said, now, this is his analogy that he used. Makes a lot of sense to me. Now, let's say I walked up literally to a sheep herd, and they know that every night the wolves pick off a couple of them. What if I went up to the sheep and said, you want to have a shot at the wolves? I'm going to give you a pistol. You can actually even the playing field with these wolves whose fangs are out. You could shoot them and save your family. Stern said he's anti-violent and admits that he couldn't hurt a fly if confronted and labels himself as a sheep. But he said there are such horrible monsters in our world. The wolves are always plotting. They'll use box cutters. They'll use an airplane. They don't need AR-15s, which is exactly the point I made. He said, if we're sheep, wouldn't you want the sheep to be armed to protect themselves from the wolves? It's a good example. He says, taking away people's rights. He said he's not for taking away people's rights, and he thinks the answer doesn't lie in taking any kind of ability of the sheep to protect themselves from the wolves. I wish it was that simple. When Howard Stern, of all people, is making a lot of sense on this issue, there you are. Something's changed. There's a lot of people out there, I think, now that you can't just blame the gun, especially when people are using bombs and other weapons. He said box cutters, airplanes. It's not going to, the banning this one type of weapon might make you feel good, but it's not going to change anything. And then there's so much misconceptions about the gun use. It's not technically a real assault weapon because you still have to pull the trigger every time you shoot. It says high magazines, but you still have to pull the trigger every time you shoot. It's not an AK-47. Not only that, but they say it's a weapon of war. I guarantee you, our soldiers are not using that kind of weapon in a war. They're not. They would die. It's not a weapon of war. Most weapons of war are banned. And you could argue if those should be banned or not, it's a whole different show. But let's be factual about this. The reason they want to ban this is it makes them feel better about themselves. But it's naive. I'm sorry, it's naive. That's what I think. What do you guys think? You can comment on the show anytime. By the way, now, on a little bit of a lighter note, we're going to end the show with stories so beyond reason, they'll leave you flabbergasted. Enough of the serious stuff. We're going to get into the weekend, and the story that I have is very interesting, to say the least. You were listening to Beyond Reason Radio here at beyondreasonradio.com. Beyond Reason Radio app. Remember, you can get the podcast of the show anytime. If you miss any of the show, you can listen to the podcast on a number of different places, iTunes, Spreaker, TuneIn, all that stuff, and then share with your friends. That'd be nice. So we can talk serious issues in Orlando. And, well, I'll be right back.
Listen to the latest episodes of Beyond Reason. Download the podcast at Spreaker.com. It would be beyond reason not to listen to Yaffee on your TuneIn Radio app. Download the app today and search Beyond Reason Radio.
Yes, if you have the TuneIn Radio app, that is a good place to listen to Beyond Reason Radio. All of the Beyond Reason Radio podcasts are on there. Great place to listen and share with your friends. Pretty much any podcast outlet that there is out there, you can listen to the show and share it. I've made it very easy to get the show. And you can just download the Beyond Reason Radio app or on iTunes or Google Play as well. And then when I do the show live, you can listen on the app as well. You can chat with the show and Facebook. And there's always different ways coming out. And, well, you can do it. No excuse. No excuse. This is Orlando Smart Talk Radio. We get into some deep issues. But we usually like to end the show with a little bit of something else.
There are a lot of stories that are beyond reason. But some stories are so unbelievable, so crazy, so unexpected, that there is only one way to describe Yaffee's reaction. Now for stories so beyond reason, they left Yaffee flabbergasted.
Yes, and the crowd goes wild, of course. Stories so beyond reason that they left me, and they will leave you flabbergasted, because they are definitely, definitely out there. And I found one story that should be pretty interesting. So we'll get to that in a second. Okay, here we go. Where's the story? Alright. This story will definitely leave you flabbergasted. Here it is. Cause of brawl at Florida bar. A fart. Yes, a fart. The argument was due to someone farting. This was a whole brawl that happened in a Florida bar. Of course it happens in Florida. Of course it happens in my state. Or does, they call it. That's what police were told after responding to a fight between two couples at Key West Sloppy Joe's bar last Monday. It's not clear how exactly the fart set off the fight. I mean, how does that set off a fight? But police say an argument over a fart was what sparked an incident which went down like this. Let me get some more details of this story because I don't understand here. It says others then. Oh, jeez. Richard McBride, 53, and a girlfriend were at the bar with friends. Stoner allegedly had words with another woman and then aggressively confronted the woman. Others then got involved, including a man who tried to pull Stoner away. All of this was apparently started with a fart. Over a fart. This is what we fight over now? I mean, some farts are pretty, pretty bad. But to get in a brawl, I mean, maybe, I don't know. I don't know. And of course it happened in Florida. And then I like how the story ends here. Not surprisingly, police say alcohol was likely involved. Of course it was. Of course it was. So if that doesn't leave you flabbergasted, I don't know what will. Okay. I want to end the show with a little bit longer of a verse here. With the whole thing, the week's been crazy. Everything we've been going through, it's always good to go to the Word of God for answers. And this is from Romans chapter 12, verse 9. I'm going to read pretty much the whole chapter. It's short. But I want you, it's just good. Hopefully it'll give you some hope as we go into the weekend. Love must be sincere. Hate what is evil. Cling to what is good. Be devoted to one another in brotherly love. Honor one another above yourselves. Never be lacking in zeal, but keep your spiritual fervor serving the Lord. Be joyful in hope, patient in affliction, faithful in prayer. Share with God's people who are in need. Practice hospitality. Bless those who persecute you. Bless and do not curse. Rejoice with those who rejoice. Mourn with those who mourn. Live in harmony with one another. Do not be proud, but be willing to associate with people of low position. Do not be conceited. Do not repay anyone evil for evil. Be careful to do what is right in the eyes of everybody. If it is possible, as far as it depends on you, live at peace with everyone. Do not take revenge, my friends, but leave room for God's wrath. For it is written, "It is mine to avenge, I will repay," says the Lord. On the contrary, if your enemy is hungry, feed him. If he is thirsty, give him something to drink. If doing this, you will heap burning coals on his head. Do not be overcome by evil, but overcome evil with good. I thank you all for joining me. We got into some deep issues. I will be back on Monday. By the way, just a note, I am hosting Good Morning Orlando on News Radio 102.5 Monday, Tuesday, and Wednesday of next week, 6 to 9 a.m. News Radio 102.5 WFLA. You're definitely going to want to tune in. And, well, I'll talk to you guys then.